Okay, now we'll talk about the system part. So this coexistence is played out in form of systems. Like we were saying, every unit is actually an organization of its components, right? So they are doing coordinated, collaborative actions. This is what a system is, right? So let's study what a system is. Next. So the principle on which the system is based is recognizing and responding. So one atomic particle recognizes the other recognizes the first one, and they both come into a system, which is known as the atom. Okay. Similarly, you can see in planets and everything, so many systems you can see. So the second important aspect to this is every system is governed by natural law, natural regulation, and natural balance. And in the human domain, these natural law, natural regulation, natural balance becomes justice, order, and truth. So justice is law in humans. Righteousness or orderliness is regulation in when you are righteous, when you are conscious of, aware of righteousness, then you self-regulate, right? And truth. Truth is to ensure continuity, right? So these three, law, regulation, and balance, where we use in terms of the other three orders, and in the human domain, we use justice, righteousness, and truth. So all systems, so natural systems are governed by natural law, natural regulation, and natural balance. And human systems are governed by justice, righteousness, and truth. Okay, next. And it is needed to be said, if in human system these are absent, then it is not a system. A system is with a definite purpose, okay? Definite constituents, definite activities, and definite value. Value is for the higher level, next level. Its value is basically what it contributes. Like a mango tree contributes the chemical which is there, which is the flavor, which is the every tree or every plant is basically a chemical factory. It is manufacturing one specific type of chemical which is useful for the nature. So they are all chemically very different. So each tree is providing the value by making that chemical in a natural way. Right? Similarly, every animal does a certain conduct. Like in Chhattisgarh where we live, there it's basically black cotton soil. And it's a clay. And the clay's nature of clay is that when it rains, it doesn't let water go through. It holds the water. Right? So there, in the black soil there, there are many crabs. And what do crabs do? They make holes with their claws, because that soil is otherwise very hard. Wherever there is contact with water, it becomes soft and it covers the surface. Below it, it's hard. And these crabs make these holes and the water percolates into the soil. Right? Similarly, in some places, earthworms do the same thing. So there are many mechanisms to achieve the same purpose in nature. Everybody is adding their value. So what is the value of giraffe? It is able to prune trees at the top, tall trees, which is needed for the balance, for their good growth. What is the value of, say, elephants? When they move along, when they migrate, they also do some sort of pruning and things. They break some branches, they help in process of some cyclic processes of growth of certain plants. Have you heard the story of Dodo? Dodo used to be a bird on one of these islands to the east of Africa. So when people reached there, locals, this was inhabited planet, and when people reached from Europe there, they found this big bird which could not fly, and since it didn't have any kind of predators and its nature was friendly, it would come near. So it was very easy to kill and eat. So there was also a saying in English, like dud as a dodo, which basically means something as stupid which goes to its killer very easily and gets killed, something like that. Anyway, so all that killing took place, and there came a time when the dodos went extinct. All the dodos were killed. Okay. Now, since all the dodos are dead, they're gone. Story finished. After several years, in fact, couple of decades, people started realizing that certain kind of tree is not growing anymore. The older trees are there, but new ones are not sprouting. So they did a research and they discovered that that tree's germination was dependent on dodo eating the seeds, and when it passed those seeds in its stool, then they would germinate. So since the dodo wasn't there, so they have stopped germinating. You will find this a lot. Lot of birds eat certain seeds and then they germinate. So everything has got its value in the system. We don't realize the value doesn't mean that it is useless. That's the basic thing. That is the basic mistake we are calling. Like, at times we have even called some parts of our body as vestigial. Maybe we have not yet discovered the usage of it, value of it, how it affects the body. Right? Anyway, so everything adds value. So a system is with a definite purpose. A system has definite constituents. A system has definite activities, and it gives a certain contribution in form of value in the larger system. So let's take our favorite example of tree, right? So a tree has a purpose. Yes, its purpose is to provide nutrition. Some trees provide nutrition to humans, some provide to certain kind of animals, to certain kind of birds. So some provide nutrition for other plant life. So trees are there for providing nutrition, basically. So that is the purpose. And what are the activities in a tree? So its roots are doing certain activity, its stem is doing some activity, its branches are doing some activity, its leaves are doing some activity, its flowers are doing some activity, some fruits are doing some activity. Right? These are all the components of the tree. So they are all doing their independent activities and contributing for the flourishing of the tree. And as a whole, this tree adds a value in the nature. So tree is a system. So a good question to ask yourselves could be, say, the community we live in, is that a system? Yet? If it is yes, what is its purpose? What are its constituents? What are the activities you are doing? What is the value we are adding as a community? Is the families that exist in present form, are they a system? Like this we can ask. Is our nation a system yet? Is there a definite purpose? Are there definite activities, definite constituents, definite value it's giving? So in the human domain, when we ask this question, we have our doubts, which basically means we need to realize these parts, which we haven't. Okay. Next. So the system of the existence is in form of a coexistential system, and on a planet it plays out as four orders. So what are these four orders? That we'll study, right? But any questions about system? What we just saw? So we taught the basic principle behind systems is recognition and respond. This is the mechanism on basis of which system stands. Then it is governed by natural laws, natural regulation, natural balance, and in humans, justice, righteousness, and truth. A system is with a definite purpose, definite constituents, definite activity, and definite value. Right? So, any questions or clarification? Otherwise, we can move ahead. Okay. So, if you look at the coexistential harmony, this definition we have already seen when coexistence, that each unit with its own uniqueness is an order in itself while participating in the larger order. So say from an atom to molecule to complex molecules to DNA to a biological cell to say plant life, complex plant life, geographical location areas, then planet, solar systems, galaxies, and beyond. These are all various forms of systems. And they are all in harmony. Except for some bit here. And similarly, there could be similar bits here to, there to, which are yet to discover harmony. Next, knowledge of coexistential harmony. So existence is coexistential order. This we have already taught. Next, order or system, I'll keep using interchangeably. Order is equal to a system with definite purpose, constituents, activity, okay? And role in larger order or value in larger order. Okay. Next. At the planetary level, there are four orders in nature. So, for these four orders to happen, there are three kinds of activities. One is the physical interactions, chemical interaction, and the conscious interactions. So, there are three activities which form these four orders. So, if you see processes, any process, you'll find components of physical activity, chemical activity, or conscious activity. Like in animals and humans, you'll find conscious activity too. But in mineral and plant world, you'll only find physical and chemical activities. Okay, next. Causality for all three activity is order in atoms. So atomic level, everything is also orderly. And this is the basis for all the further activity, right? Whether it is physical activity, it is also rooted in atoms. Each atom has some heat. Each atom has some sort of electric potential. Each atom has some sort of vibration in form of sound, some frequency which it transmits. Similarly, each atom can, each insentient atom participates in the chemical activities also. Oxygen and hydrogen combine to form the water, right? And the conscious atom is does the conscious act. Okay. Next. All the subtle level, at the subtle level, there is orderliness in atoms. This we have stated. Next. So, all the stable configurations, which are basically structures, and definite properties of atoms is equal to insentient atoms. So basically what we're trying to say here is that the configurations are themselves a harmony. What we are calling stable, like hydrogen is a harmonious configuration. Carbon is a harmonious configuration. Nitrogen is a harmonious configuration. I'll give you an example to understand this. Suppose we had a guitar here and I plucked the string at any point. There will be a sound, right? But it's not a musical note. There are only seven musical notes. There are only seven harmonies on that string. Right? So, of the all the possible permutation and combinations, these harmonious combinations, harmonious stable configuration. These are the structures which continue. And they continue along with being harmonious and continuous, they exhibit definite properties. Right? Every atom you must have studied in school, high school, they teach you that every atom has fixed chemical and physical properties. Right? Whether the hydrogen is in India or US or Moon, it can be detected because it has fixed properties. Right? So they have definite properties. So all insentient atoms have definite properties and definite structures. Perfectly structured atom G1 is the sentient atom. Okay? And its properties are exhibiting consciousness. And consciousness is in form of that table which we showed. There are levels from man, vritti, chit, buddhi, atma. And it has its forces and it has its activities. Right? Next. At causality level, there is balancing activity. So, what we are talking about here is that the system is stable because every system has a mechanism of balancing itself. Like in atoms also, the particles are moving very fast. The nucleus is also moving. And this atom is not alone. There are many atoms around it. So at times, there might be some influence of other atoms around it, which might attract the particles participating in this configuration towards outside. In such situations, the nucleus exerts a force and controls it. Science, the same thing is said by saying that if the particle has to move out, it will need more energy. This is the least energy model. Therefore, it's stable in the orbit. Right? So here we're saying the same event by saying that nucleus maintains the balance. So there is a balancing activity which is taking place at every system. Therefore, that sustains the system. There is one, the structure will be stable, and to a certain extent, it will be able to stay stable even in adverse conditions, to a certain limit. If the external influence is beyond that limit, then the structures do break down. Right? But in normal conditions, most of the structures do not exert that kind of forces on each other. It's only in special circumstances that happen. Okay, next. At the fundamental level, there is coexistence of space and matter. So we are basically talking about this coexistential harmony from fundamental level to causality level to subtle level and to the gross level. Right? So because this is so at the fundamental level, because of this, there is this tendency. Because of this tendency, this is there. And because of this, at the gross level that we see organization, like this wall, we can rely on this wall because it has definite properties. Why does it have definite properties? Because building blocks of this wall are mud bricks. Mud bricks have definite properties. Why does mud brick have definite properties? Because mud, the kind of composition we have used here, the minerals which we have used here have definite properties. Why do those minerals have definite property? Because the molecules making that mineral have definite properties. Why does molecules building that system have definite properties? Because atoms making up that molecule have definite properties. Why does the atom have definite properties? Because there is a balancing activity which enables the definiteness in it. And why is this tendency there? Because of the fundamental level, there is coexistence of space and matter, because of which every particle is energized, it is active, and it is regulated. This is the basis of definite and stable nature of everything. This is what is being trying to be said from here. The whole question of causality. Why is anything happening around here? In the way it is happening, the manner and in the form. It is because of this connection. Fundamental level, causality level, subtle level and gross level. This is all unified. Like one of the questions which we came across when I was studying quantum physics was that quantum world is so undeterministic, how do we relate it to the day-to-day life level world? So that is one of the gaps which need to be fulfilled. I don't know where science has gone there yet, but here we are talking about it like this. This is another way of looking at it. Anyway, next. So this we had already seen in the thing, that the fundamental level is basically insentient and sentient matter is saturated or permeated, soaked, submerged, surrounded in all pervasive space. There is change of words. Okay. Yes.
A sentient atom come into being.
What do you mean first?
Say in the womb or something. Like how did the chimpanzee atom become human?
Chimpanzee atom doesn't become human.
I mean, there's a jivan.
I got it. So, whenever we use the word first, which basically means there is reference to time. So now we have come into constraints of space and time. In existence, there is no first. In existence, there is atom, there is conscious atom, there are chemicals, there are chemical activity, so all the states are existent at all times. There is no first and there is no. But if we start looking in certain space and time, then we can say, okay, this is happening first here, there is a sequence here, all that we can talk. So time comes in whenever we focus at something. Take a part of something, okay? That is first important point. Now, the process of evolution. The process of evolution, we need to talk about that. So, a planet is a collection of lot of matter, right? And matter, by virtue of it being energized, active, and regulated, has a tendency to come together, to coexist. This tendency leads to formation, leads to collection, whatever form it might be in that situation. Suppose it's form of subatomic particle. Then it will become in form of atoms and molecules. Then it will clump together and become something like a planet. If there is large enough matter, right? And if it is not large enough, then whatever other stages are there of pre-planet forming states. It will be in those. It could be asteroid belt or whatever. So once planet forms, right? Now there is direction in nature because all matter is submerged in perfect. So perfection has to take place. So in this planet, suppose there are only few elements right now. And the elements which are needed for further progress are not there. So initially the processes which will take place on this planet will be the formation of the other elements. And in the quantities which is needed for that planet for the further progress to happen. So suppose there is less oxygen. So initially the formation of more oxygen will take place till the time the amount which is needed is there. Suppose there is too much sulfur dioxide, so the level of sulfur dioxide will go down, thing like that, right? And I'm not going to say that first the planet will become stable in its motions and thing like that, and then atmosphere formation and the sea formation. And all. I'm not going into each and every small step, basically. So first elements will form. When all the elements needed in the right ratio have formed, then the chemical processes kick in, right? Like on our planet, water was one of the first chemicals. And once the water formed, it is on the land. Land is minerals. The various minerals interact with water. So you have acids and alkalis. So chemical reactions are taking place. And the acids and alkalis are interacting with each other. Acids are interacting with acids also. Alkalis are acting with other alkalis also. So various chemical reactions take place. And this leads to a very diverse chemical world. And from this diverse chemical world arises the organic chemical world, the carbon-based chemical world. And that again complexity, because again, there is a tendency, there is a direction in this. That effort we talked about. We talked about effort, motion, and structure. So the effort from one state to a higher state, one state to a higher state, right? That effort is there. So whenever whatever is needed happens, and then the next stage emerges. Then the next process is set in. Then their impact is there as much as needed. Then the next stage emerges. The next process happens. So this happens for millions and millions of years. And this process from this chemical world arises the first biological life in form of very rudimentary, say, cell. And what happens in the cell is they have the ability to multiply. So they start multiplying. When the number of cells of that kind is sufficient, then more complex cells start arising from this. It changes. It evolves from this on itself. Then you have multicellular organisms. From multicellular to more complex, right? So this process goes on till there's enough biological life to support the animal life. And then the animal's life starts happening. So like this, the process keeps on going, right? So when the animal life arrives, there comes a stage when the animal evolution has come to a place where well-developed brains are now there. Okay? And in the meantime, from the physical atom, this conscious atom has also emerged. So now the bodies are also here, and the conscious atoms are also here. So they start running these bodies.
The evolution of the atom is also taking place, say, a body only, an animal body.
No, not necessarily. Not necessarily.
Like in Neanderthals or, say, demo, like all the different species of pre-human, like other species of human beings. So it was taking place there or something.
They all were with jivan, because even monkeys have, even cows have, even birds have jivan. Right, so even before Neanderthals and everybody else, before that also there, but they are in that is the animal form, right? What is the human form? We do not determine the human form by the physicality of it. Here, the human form is the one which has the freedom of willful action and the power of imagination. If they are exhibiting this, then they are human. Whether Cro-Magnon man was doing it, lived like that. It definitely shows they were like that. Neanderthals were also like that. They were all humans. So,
an atom.
So the development in atom now, once it's structurally complete, there won't be any quantitative changes in it, because it's structurally complete. So only changes will happen is in qualitatively. So qualitative changes are in terms of awareness. So if you look at animals, like a snake is aware of certain kind of things, right? Say a crow can be aware of certain other kind of things. So jivans which are running these have the ability or the awareness of those things, right? Whereas, say, cows or, say, horses or, say, elephants, they have a lot more awareness than these. They exhibit a lot more. There is also another correlation you can see. The correlation is that as the awareness level increases, the tendency to nurture its offsprings and the complexity of the processes they use increases. So you see the nurturing ability in animals increasing as you go towards mammals. It starts from reptiles. Some snakes make a nest, right? But they probably do not feed their young ones, right? Birds also feed their young ones. animals, mammals not only feed their young ones, they also protect them till a certain age. They carry them with together. So the more complex processes are taking place. So the level of awareness in jivan is increasing. Right? Like that. So qualitatively, the difference is in level of awareness.
And they are happening in those five vrittis.
Most of this is happening in man.
Man.
In the animal state. It's only in human that the awareness level, the thinking process actually kicks in. See, thinking process is needed for imagination as well as willful action. Thinking and visualization. Which is not to say there will be no visualization or no thinking. But it's rudimentary, it's for the body. For example, a monkey can come into a house, open a fridge and take something out. This cannot happen without thinking and visualization. But it will only do this much for maintaining its body. Right? Not beyond that. Like, you know how they trap some monkeys? Kinds of monkeys. Like, this is a very traditional African tribe trick. They'll take make a hole in a anthill or something like that and put something edible which smells nice, which monkey can detect in it, but big enough that the hole is just small enough for it to put hand like this, but once it grabs it, it cannot withdraw its hand. So the monkey doesn't know that if it drops it, it can get out. It gets trapped and they catch it. Okay. So they have the abilities, but they are basic, very basic. They are much more functional in humans, but still very partial. We are not even using about 10-15% of our ability. Any other question?
Just one more. A more interesting question becomes, how did plants, considering they didn't have a jivan, a sentient atom, how did that come about in plants? From plants to animals, like, where did that jump happen?
So, plants to animal bodies is a biological connection. Right? So, if you look at some plants, so, even plants evolution you can see happening from less complex to more complex, right? So animals are what? They are basically a biological entity which is actually moving. It's basically most distinct feature is its ability to move. So for it to move, it has two kinds of tissues. One, because it has to move, it needs to be joined together. So it has connective tissues. So it has muscles. Right? But it has, when you have to move, one unit with many parts has to move together, it needs to be connected, and also it needs coordination. So for coordination, it needs a nervous system. So beginning of animal life is where you find muscles as well as nervous system together. Nervous system is not there anywhere else, right? It starts in animals. Like if I have to move, if I have to get up, everything is coordinated, na? If I have to take a step, there is a balance at the back. Now balance is shifted here. Everything is coordinated. Even an earthworm which is going like this or a caterpillar going like this, there's a lot of coordination taken. So, coordination between all the parts is through nervous tissue, for which you need a small brain, a central unit. So, here we make the distinction between animals and plants on basis of this. Wherever there is a brain and nervous system and muscles, that is an animal. And it comes from there only. The genetic material, see, what are these forms? The forms are basically, there is at a level of biological cell, there is something called genetic material. Genetic material is a chain of molecules, right? And its special ability is that it is able to take chemicals from its environment and rearrange into a form which is similar to itself. So it's a chain, and it takes the chemicals and puts in there, and this chain separates. Takes more material. So it has the ability of multiplying like that. This multiplication leads to growth. This is why we see growth in biological life. Right? Now, this process is happening. Along with this, now this unit starts moving. Now this has become an animal. If it is not moving in coordinated motion, then it's a plant.
But how does a carbon atom which exists in plants become a sentient atom which has man, vritti, chit, and even if man is just operating in animal?
Yeah. So this transition of physical to chemical doesn't take place in plants or animals. It takes place somewhere on the planet. Whatever position, it happens. Basically, let's take it that. It is not happening, a plant is there and then there will be a conscious atom will become and then the body will come and they'll both join. It's not happening at the same location. On the planet itself, somewhere there are these conscious atoms which are formed at one time. And along with that, parallelly, this evolution of the physical form is taking place. So from minerals to biological life to more complex biological life to animals. And animals, more complex animals, these two join together and start functioning together. This needs a vehicle to move. It sees the vehicle is available. It starts moving with this. Plants are not making conscious atoms. And on the planet somewhere, it's such a small quantity. Once I was doing calculation with another friend, how much matter would be converted to conscious matter for all the animals and humans alive and without body. So we took a factor of, say, for every human being alive, there are 100 jeevans which are not running a body. We took that factor. And for every animal which is body is being run, there are 1,000 which are not running the body, suppose. Taking this factor and using the mole principle to calculate, we came up with, like, it was less than 1/100th of a gram. So, tip of your hair is enough matter for all the jeevans on this planet. So, where will this happen is insignificant. Otherwise, it seems to be so much matter would have to be done. You need to come for the attention. Okay? All these calculations have a logical explanation. You can come. We can do that. So it happens on this planet itself. See, some people might say, how do you know it happens on this planet? It might have come from some other planet. Let's say, okay, it has happened somewhere. Wherever it has happening, it will happen in this existence only, na? It will convert because this conscious atom is also made up of electron, proton, neutrons only. It's not made up of anything else. That is the amazing part. It is just the number of atoms which are there. Number of particles in this atom, which is 61, and their arrangement. In this configuration, only one particle is at the nucleus and 60 particles are in the orbits. Whereas in physical atoms, if you see, or the insentient atoms you see, the number of particles in the orbit and the number particle in the nucleus will either have equal number or more than the orbit. Here it's a different configuration, absolutely.
Does it reconcile with your study of quantum mechanics?
See, quantum mechanics logic is based on different principles, and the logic of this is based on different principles. So I would not say. Yeah. Here we don't say that. Matter doesn't change into energy. If energy is fundamental energy, space, matter doesn't change into that. We are only talking about the relative energy, that is organizational when structures change. When from complex to less complex, there will always be release of energy. Okay.
How come we never studied this in science? I mean, the G1 atom, something like this.
It is not there in the curriculum there. It's a new discovery. Hopefully, it will become part of curriculum someday. And it will only become part if people like you and me are able to study it and come into the right conduct. That will inspire others to have this in the curriculum. But if we are not able to do it, then this will also not become part. You were asking something? Okay, next. So this we have seen, four orders, what are the four orders, right? So do it once again so that people get. So everything on this planet is in the material order, right? But amongst the everything that is there, and we are calling it all things made up of matter, there are certain things which are also breathing, right? That is all biological order. And amongst this breathing things, there are certain things which are also moving. The movement is whether in air or water or on land, right? These all are in animal order. And within this, there is knowledge order. Knowledge order is the order which functionally shows power of imagination and power of willful action, plus they become orderly with knowledge. They can participate in the natural order through knowledge. That's where the name knowledge order, to remind all the time. So all things made up of matter, respiring, self-aware, and having awareness of purpose. Next. So we have been talking about insentient and sentient. In terms of orders, if we see it, so material order and biological order is insentient, animal order and knowledge order is sentient. Here, jivan is there in some animals, and all humans have jivan. So, in material order, if you see, predominantly physical activity is taking place, right? In biological order, predominantly chemical activity is taking place. In animal order, physical chemical activity, which is the body, plus conscious activity with basic intellect. We talked about rudimentary intellect. In knowledge order, here see we put the body first and the jivan second. Here the jivan is first, the complete conscious, spiritual, intellect activity and chemical, physical activity body. Any questions? Next. One more click. This is Drishta's work. The animation part. Okay? So, material order is being useful to the biological order as well as the animal order, as well as to the knowledge order. Biological order is being useful to the animal order as well as the knowledge order. And it is complementing the material order. Animal order is being useful to the knowledge order and complementing the biological order as well as the material order. Knowledge order is getting support from all the three, but is it being complementary to biological or animal or material order? So its role is, and its responsibility is yet to be fulfilled. This is where we are. Everything else is working fine. It's this which needs to complete this picture. If these arrows become solid, this picture will be complete. Yes, please.
Uncle, can you just explain the difference between use and complement?
It's basically contributing to each other. One. So when complement we use, then it is basically completing something. How do you complete something? So whatever the purpose of something, and it activity is for some purpose. So when you start supporting that activity for that purpose by making some contribution, that is called complementing. Right? So go back to the I'll be sharing these presentations with you. Read. Okay. So, say let's take biological order and material order. So, say take a tree, and from material order, let's take soil. The whole purpose of material order is what? In this model, because there is a direction, material order's purpose is to become balanced enough to first let plant order or biological order emerge and then sustain it. That is its purpose. So the balance in the material order is so that the biological life can be sustained. So the biological life, like trees, its leaves, its branches, and when it dies, all its remnants help the soil to be enriched. The fertility of the soil chemically in the mineral world is to a certain extent. But the moment it starts coming from the biological world, it is much more fertile. So it's able to do its job much better and much simpler. That's why organic fertilizers work much better than the chemical fertilizer, right? So that is complementing. Material order is useful. Its value can be utilized by this. And this, its remnants can help it. Similarly, in animal order, animals utilize plant biological order. They eat it and everything. But in the biological life, to regulate there are diseases in forests also, right? A lot of time. Animals' urine, their sweat, their body, hair, so many things which they do, their breathing, it all has an impact. And when I'm talking animals, I'm talking about from insects, smallest insects, to say mammals, huge number. So all their living activity as well as the remnants of their body help in maintaining the balance of plant order, biological order. That is their complementariness. But this one is not doing anything in return yet. It is just a taker, not a giver yet. No. He's a born, unaware entity. Villain to villainy is with intent. When you make a mistake unknowingly, don't we say, I made that by mistake. I didn't know. I wasn't aware. So you can't blame. You can only help learn. See, the moment you start making it a villain, you will want to move away from it. That is very important to know that. We are part of it and the whole humanity is together in this. We cannot reject any part of it. And the only thing which we can conclude here is that because of lack of education, we are unaware. So the only work in front of us is let's make, enrich the education system. Let's enrich our social systems so that we can live in harmony. And we have enough opportunities in whatever place we are living. You don't have to migrate to any other place. If you're living in your flat in Delhi, whether you're living in mountains, whether you're living in your village, everywhere there is ample opportunity to work for education, to work for social improvement of social systems. You just have to reorient yourself. That's why I keep insisting, it's take responsibility yourself. That is the main thing. Okay. Any questions? Next. So there is a sequence of emergence, right? So first the material order will be there, then the biological order, then the animal order, and then the knowledge order. This sequence can't be bypassed. Second, lower orders are useful for the higher orders, and the higher orders are complemental to the lower orders. Higher orders are nurtured and secured in the equilibrium of the lower orders. This is important to know. If there is no equilibrium in the material order, plant order can't be sustained. If there is no equilibrium in the material order and biological order, then the animal order cannot be sustained. And if there is no equilibrium in the material order, biological order, and animal order, the knowledge order can't be sustained. Yeah? Ha. So equilibrium is everything is doing its activity in full functionality and in balance with others. Such a state becomes the complete balance which occurs because of this. So everything is doing its things in full in its full conduct, in harmony with each other and the full stability. And this continues. This is called equilibrium. Equilibrium is not a static thing, it's a dynamic thing. This is very important to know that equilibrium is dynamic. In past we have thought of like things will harmonize if there is no activity. Inactivity is not equilibrium. And inactivity actually is not possible. We have tried a lot. I have not yet been able to have any evidence of it. We have been trying to, in physical world, we are trying to stop the atom by cooling it down to the absolute zero. Not yet been able to do that. And in the conscious world, all the messages in the meditation is that you stop all activity. Physical activity, first you stop the social activity, then your biological and physical activity, and even your conscious activity. Stop, state of no thought, state of no desire. These are impossible states. non-sustainable states. Even if somebody claims to have reached them, they're non-sustainable. They can't multiply, they can't be for everyone. So you have to reach a state of functioning. Functioning in harmony. There you can have equilibrium. If everybody functions in harmony, then we can be in equilibrium. And that is what continues. Okay?
So what would be an equilibrium in material order?
So, where all the minerals, while doing their activities, all the gases, all the liquids, right? They come, form a biosphere in which the biological life emerges. So in the mineral world, what happens is, you come to a stage where the temperature, pressure, humidity comes into a regulated range. And within this regulated range, the biological life emerges.
The evidence that one level is in equilibrium is that it will lead to the next.
The presence of the next is the indication.
That, huh.
Yeah.
Ki the previous, the lower order is now, was in equilibrium.
And equilibrium, there is a range of it. Right now we are fooling around with this range. We are trying to disturb it. So once it goes beyond that range, then things will go haywire for us. Because then the process will reset and try to come into a new equilibrium in which a lot of damage can be done to us. But it will restart. Whatever mess we might create, because nature's tendency is to be in equilibrium, it will restart the process. Okay, next. Let's study a little bit of material order. If I'm going too fast, please let me know. My speed increases if there are no questions. If there are questions, I slow down. So if you think it's too fast, then ask. Okay. So in the material order, as we talked about earlier, that every unit is basically a organization of its components. So for every unit, there is formation. Like many atoms can come together to become a molecule. Right? So there is formation. Once the formation takes place, there is continuation. That molecule stays there for some time. Right? Once the molecule is formed, it will continue to be in the form of molecule for some time. And there will be a stage when it will break down, right? Which we'll call deformation. Have you noticed this happening around you? No. For example, if you take a tray of water, put it in the freezer. After some time, it will freeze. What has happened? All those water molecules which were loose have come together much closer and become a solid form. Right? Now, if you take it out, it will stay in form of ice for some time and then it will melt again into water. So, that distance will have increased. So, any organization which is there at gross level, it is there for some duration only. It is not for very long. This building we have made. Right? The structure will be there for some time till we are maintaining it. But there is a duration to it. After that, it will break down. Right? Even a rock, it can last for thousands of years, but it will break down at one sometime. So we are calling it formation and deformation, and in between there is continuation. So when things form, like a rock can form because lava has melted and it's cooled down and it's become a rock. And rock can deform because it's lying in the river and the water is flowing and slowly, slowly degraded, it's become dust. Right? But during the, before it became dust, it is in its form. This form, we are calling its continuation. The duration of formation and duration of deformation is much shorter than the duration of continuation. When things form and things go apart, this is like in short times, short duration, but they continue to be there for a longer time. Comparatively, this time is much longer. What is the significance of this phenomena? Because this is longer, therefore, this is available for a longer time. The properties which it exhibits. And this is a value. So it keeps on giving value for a longer time. Interestingly, in material order, this formation, this continuation and deformation, all is happening because of the environmental conditions, environmental influences. Like we say, stone formation. Like lava came out of the earth, it cooled down, cooling took place because of the environment, and therefore it became a rock. And then deformation, and it is continuing to be a rock in environmental conditions. And it's changing while it's there, and then it becomes dust because, say, it got degraded because it's in a river or it fell down or whatever. Some wind came, something else. So all the changes, this is one change, this is in one state, and this is another change. So change and state are all happening in the influence of the external environment conditions. So here the degree of freedom is very less or the least in the material order. Everything happens because of the environmental state. Like here if it starts raining heavily, right? So certain changes will start happening in the material. If the moisture increases, certain things will start happening. If the moisture decreases, certain other things will start. This door, the bathroom door, you know, it's hard to close. Why? Because the wood has expanded because of the moisture in the air. Right? When the humidity will go down, again it will become free to move. So all changes are because of the environmental conditions in every unit. Right? So this is the main characteristic of material order. One. Second thing is, whatever is formed here, the overall planetary system ensures whatever is needed keeps forming. Like for example, water was needed for the life to be sustained on this planet before anything else, water formed in huge quantity. But at the moment when it was formed, after that some molecules are every day breaking down. But along with that, there are some molecules are also forming the same day. At the same time. So somewhere water is, make molecules are breaking down, somewhere water molecules are forming. And the balance of this breaking down and formation and deformation, the balance in this is leading to the continuity of water molecules being available all the time. Right? So even though water formed millions of years ago, it is still available in a quantity which is needed for sustaining of life. Okay. Similarly, oxygen, similarly, every mineral. It is there in that quantity which is needed in the self-regulated system, regulated by the environment or the collaborative environment which everything contributes to and forms. This is the basic system of organization. That's why we are calling it order. Today Rajiv ji is not there. He had asked how we are calling it order. Right? So this ensuring of definitely of these minerals, and therefore the values these minerals are bringing into the system. This is what is the evidence of order.
And also possible due to human intervention?
Of course. But we are right now just discussing, suppose we were observing moon. In moon, a lot of things are there. There are a lot of minerals there. So those minerals must be breaking down because of some conditions. Like there's a lot of intense radiation from sun coming there. Right? But also because of the processes in the surface, those minerals would also be getting formed. And overall, the minerals which are there, they're having an impact that slowly, moon is getting ready for maybe further development in the material order. So humans definitely do that. We know that. We have the ability to deform. We can cut a tree. We can break down a mountain. We can dry up a river. We all know that. But I'm saying we are talking in context of only material order right now, without any external thing. So in a planet where there's only material order, there are processes which are going on, which will slowly lead to this next order. Now, one could jump to the conclusion that means all planets will become like this. I don't think so. Why not? Because for a development process to take place on a planet, there are certain influences of its surrounding planets is also needed. So they, in a solar system, maybe there are 2, 3, 4 planets where this can happen. That's my guess. So the whole solar system will have 2, 3 planets where you'll have life. It can have. And there are innumerable solar systems in the world, in the existence. Okay. Any questions on the material order? So, material order would be like all the minerals, from water to oxygen to carbon dioxide to, say, iron oxide to all the minerals which are there, coal, mineral oil, right, acids, alkalis, which are there. They all are going through this process, and they all are dynamic, and they all are in equilibrium. Right? In this material order, there is also part of minerals coming from the inside of Earth to the surface. And there are also places where minerals from the surface are going underneath. So there is a movement from surface to below. That cycle is also there. Right? Because of this, at times you have volcanoes or earthquakes. This is part of the Earth's mineral order being alive or being dynamic. It is not a static mineral order. It's a dynamic mineral order. Next. So coming together of various components, formation, short duration. Continuity of the structure formed, long duration. Deformation, breakdown of the structure, short duration. So this ensures the availability of the structure and therefore the value provided by them for the system. We have already covered this. Any questions on this? Next. Now we come to the biological order. Biological order and material order, all the processes which are taking place in the material order are also taking place in the biological order. But there is something extra which is taking place. What is this extra? This again is a structure. just like in the material order, there were structures forming. This is also complex structure in lot of molecules participating in this structure. Okay? But this structure forms in conducive environment. When the material order reaches its equilibrium, then on the surface of the planet, the biosphere, where regulated temperature, pressure, humidity, these conditions prevail. And in such conditions, the biological life emerges. And the biological life's significant part is that this structure has the ability to maintain itself, repair itself. Because it's a complex structure, all the wear tear which might take place, it takes material from outside, which we are calling ingestion, utilizes it for its functioning, for its energy, for its maintenance, and what are the remnants, it eliminates. And there is a balance in ingestion and elimination. And this balance is called nourishment. If there is imbalance of higher ingestion and less elimination, the nourishment will be lost. Like, for example, you can study a body. Your body is a biological unit. So intake is high and output is less in form of materials, right? So your excretory organs stop functioning properly. Then you will be in ill health. Suppose elimination is more than ingestion. So whatever you intaking, there is much more elimination than that. Again, you will be ill. The nourishment will only be there because of the balance between the two. And this balance is regulated here within the cell, within the biological unit. Whether it's a single cell, whether it's a multi-cell, whether it's an animal body or a human body. This will happen everywhere in the same manner. So this unit, which lives in conducive environment, has the ability to maintain its nourishment and therefore maintain itself by taking materials from outside and eliminating whatever it doesn't need and therefore keep itself alive for some time. So it has the freedom to select what it needs. This is the extra ability that biological life has. Like suppose there are mineral crystals forming somewhere. And because of some reason, some influence in the environment, or some reason, those crystals start deforming. There is no mechanism available to those crystals to repair themselves or maintain them. Whereas here, there is some mechanism available to them, which is inherent to the unit now. There, the maintenance of the crystals will be if there is conducive environment. So it will be environmental influence which will maintain it, which will form it, deform it, right? Here, the maintenance is done here. Not only maintenance, it also has the ability to reproduce. What is reproduction? It takes material from its environment and rearranges it in its own form. So the ability of formation now is instilled in the biological unit. It's not in the environment. So it's become freer in that sense. It has the ability of the formation. So the formation activity from the environment has now shifted into the unit. The unit can form more units like itself by taking materials from its environment. This is a much more evolved ability of the biological order compared to material order. Can you see the distinction? It is much more freer biological life is much more freer from its environment compared to, but this is all happening in the conducive environment. So it is able to nourish itself and it is able to reproduce. Yes.
I think another aspect of the freedom of the biological order that is brought on because of reproduction is that the process of reproduction in itself ensures that the next generation is actually more suited to being free from the environment because it adapts to the environment.
Yeah. So the adaptation is started taking place in this itself, at the biological level itself, which leads to the evolution. So every generation, there could be improvement. Or after a certain generation, there could be improvement, distinctive improvement. So biological order is like this. Slightly freer from environment compared to material order, where the activity of formation has now come into the unit. Any questions? Or shall we go to the animal order? Okay. Yeah, of course. All biological life dies. Every cell is there for some time. Here, it gets dies because it has its own duration. Every structure has a duration. Whether material order, whether biological order. Structures are there only in these two. Conscious structure is continuous, permanent. There is no deformation there. In the physical chemical world, structures have a shelf life. Yeah. No, so but this interesting thing is, if we look at this reproduction, what is reproduction? It is the biological life is actually continuing by rearranging itself. The same qualities are there in its offspring. So even though this unit will deform, but that value will still be there. This is a key point which was missed in tradition. The observation was only of the unit. It forms and deforms, therefore it's temporary. And we are saying it is continuous in forms of cyclic reproduction. Okay? Okay, next. So, biological order flourishes in conducive environment. Biological order develops ability to select and acquire required minerals from its environment for its nourishment. Biological order also has developed ability of formation in itself, reproduction ability. I have given these along with the slide so that when you're looking at these slides, you know what we were talking about here.
Okay. But it does raise the question, why, if all the nourishment is available, why is there a shelf life, actually?
Yeah. So,
why is there a limit to the duration? Because if the nourishment is there and it's abundant, why would it? Yeah.
It is the limitation of the structures which are formed at this level. These structures, though dynamic and they do come into equilibrium for some time, now this equilibrium doesn't last in these structures. So the biological process exists in form of a unit for a short duration. Because there are many things which are working together, and they are of the material order only, which are come together to form this unit. So they are also under influence. So they are working, and this arrangement has the balance for certain duration. After that duration, this balance does get disturbed. And why it gets disturbed is the question is because all this is happening on basis of energy exchanges at that level. And that goes, that balance has a duration. Basically, that is all you can say about this right now.
Okay. I think actually the image that one can form is that it becomes static. And so if it becomes static, then you kind of feel like it could then go on eternally.
Yeah. Yeah.
But actually, it's the diagram is more actually, it's dynamic. No, it grows and then it expands, but then it declines again. It's actually, it's a movement. It's never
static.
It's never static, yeah.
And there is a concept of, I don't know what better word to use for it, but because it is moving in a physical environment. All the structures, all its activity is in a physical environment. So there is going to be a wear and tear. Because, say, all the movements which are taking place, there will be friction, there will be heat, there will be other factors. So there is the ability of this system to maintain itself, repair itself to a certain extent, not beyond that extent. And it is all formed of these what you call structurally incomplete units. So they don't have that ability to bring that quality at this level. It is only in the conscious unit does that happen. One. Also, when things are in space, where they are out of the material, like Earth's atmosphere, then everything which is happening in the biological order is within, say, a planet's atmosphere, in the biosphere, basically. So biosphere, there is interaction with everything. But say things were in space, like planets moving in space, or the atoms, the particles of atoms moving in space. There is no interaction with anything else except for its own parts. So the duration there is much longer. Therefore, the biological life which is there, which is so many things together and doing so many activities together, it is in equilibrium for a short time or for a fixed duration, which is a range. We can also get to this from the fact that some get better conducive conditions, some get lesser conducive. So those which get better conducive conditions, they last slightly longer. And which get less conducive conditions, they last slightly less longer. So that is an indicator that this has an impact. So there is this environmental condition, even though it has got some independence, not fully independent of it yet. Right? Yeah, it's not independent yet. So when we study the animal order, we see it has another tendency. Same thing in the animal order, it has all the qualities of the material order as well as biological order, because it can reproduce, it can respire, but it has the ability to move. The freedom here is to choose a conducive environment. What is the extra ability in the animal order? It has the ability to choose a more conducive environment. So when the heat goes up, the plants will dry out and die. But what will the animals do? They'll move to cooler places. Right? This ability to live out this ability, they have the bodies which can move. Right? That's why they have movement. And for the movement, they have connected bodies as well as coordinated bodies, for which there are two tissues which work, minimum. So if it gets uncomfortable in this environment for them, they'll move to a better environment. So if you look at animal life, everywhere, in any form, they have their own migrations. From season to season. There is no animal life which doesn't have this. When it's on its own. When humans tie them up or do something else is a different thing. When they're in association of humans, that's a different thing. But in natural conditions, they all have their own migratory routes. And some of them are known to circumnavigate the planet in the seas. Thousands of miles, some of the animals travel on the land surface. Birds fly thousands of miles. Right? So they have the extra ability of choosing the conducive environment. Also, this also addresses this distinction, because they have the muscular tissue and the nervous tissue. For those who want to differentiate between, say, meat and vegetarian food, if anything which has nervous tissue or muscles, then it is meat, because it comes from animals. And if it is coming, doesn't have this, then it is coming from a vegetable source or the plant source. For some people, it is important to know. So here, this distinction can be made on basis of this. Okay. Any questions?
What constitutes animal order here is maybe a bit too mammalish.
Meaning?
What about, say, insects that don't actually, they don't go that far? Is there any variation in, say, the conception of Jeevan Vidya's animal order? Does all of this apply to insects?
Ah, it does, fully. They also migrate from one place to the other. Haven't you heard of swarms of these, locusts coming from Africa to India?
Even ants, no. You find at the different seasons, the ants come into the house, and then they go back out of the house again, and different parts of the garden they move depending on the climate.
In the mountains, where my mother-in-law lives, she's able to identify when it's going to rain by seeing some insects. Oh, they're out. It's going to rain. There are various other reasons. That's the most simplest we think of. Interestingly, all animals can swim. It's only humans who need to learn to swim. But how much water is there to form them to cross? That different. That is different for different species. Right? Anyway, our time is over. We'll come back and continue this after lunch. Oh, you had something to say? Okay. Let's.
I was going to say that even like moving, it doesn't have to be like a long migration, but even like if an animal is too hot, it just moves to a water body next, you know, just to cool down or to drink water or, you know, just it could just be even a small, but just to move. To find shade or something. I mean, even that could be like, it doesn't have to be a long migration, right? Just to change the environment or meet their need or something.
So the movement is for, the characteristic of movement, if we want to look at it as a quality, then it is there in every species of animals. Quantity-wise, it varies. Who moves how much? Okay, thank you.